You don't have to split up if you don't want to. You all want to gather one side or the other. Let the Spirit of God come in. Welcome to worship at Lindsay United Methodist Church. We thank you for being here. If you're joining us streaming live, if you're joining us on the radio, if you're joining us streaming later, we thank you in whatever way you choose to worship with us. We do have a few announcements I want to make. Wednesday evenings, we still have Bible study going on. And choir rehearsal at 5:30. Bible studies at 6. No Bible study. No Bible study this week. Okay. I take that back. But we'll probably have choir this week at 5:30. We need donations for the food pantry. Please, if you can, help support that program, because that is an outreach ministry that we do as a church. There are other activity dates on the bulletin. You need to check those. And I have one important announcement here. It is now official, I guess you could say. We will be receiving a new pastor on October 22nd. His name is Reverend Alan Nagel. And he comes to us from Tuttle, if I'm not mistaken. So Mr. Nagel will be here then. And please help us welcome him. Bring all your friends. And let's welcome Mr. Nagel.
Is that
on the 22nd?
On the 22nd. We will have donuts and coffee before
service. I love donuts. They're like my favorite. Sounds good to me. I'll be here then, in that case. Let's prepare our hearts for worship this morning. The Lord be with you, and also with you. And as we enter into worship, let us come into his presence with thanksgiving and sing praises to his holy name. And we're going to do just that. So please stand as you are able, and we're going to sing, "He Has Made Me Glad," like we did last week. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Rejoice, for he has made me glad. Rejoice, for he has made me glad." She snuck that one in there. Actually, she didn't. She told me she was going to do that. And I forgot. Please join me in the call to worship. From Psalm 95. "O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great ruler above all gods. The Lord is our God. We are the people of God's pasture. the sheep of God's hand. Amen. And we are going to sing Praise the Lord with the Sound of Trumpet. It's in the Faith We Sing book. Praise the Lord with the sound of trumpet. Praise the Lord with the harp and lute. Praise the Lord with the gentle sounding flute. Praise the Lord in the field and forest. Praise the Lord in the city square. Praise the Lord any time and anywhere. Praise the Lord in the wind and sunshine. Praise the Lord in the dark of night. Praise the Lord in the rain or snow or in the morning light. Praise the Lord in the deepest valley. Praise the Lord on the highest hill. Praise the Lord, never let your voice be still. Praise the Lord with the crashing cymbal. Praise the Lord with the pipe and string. Praise the Lord with the joyful songs we sing. Praise the Lord on a weekday morning. Praise the Lord on a sun and moon. Praise the Lord by the light of sun or moon. Praise the Lord in the time of sorrow. Praise the Lord in the time of joy. Praise the Lord every moment. Nothing let your praise destroy. Praise the Lord in the peace and quiet. Praise the Lord in your work or play. Praise the Lord everywhere and every way. And now we're going to sing A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevails. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sighs. Let goods and kindred go. This mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. Before we do that, I'd just like to make just a short statement about, if you missed the men's prayer breakfast this morning, you missed a real blessing. Lynn Scruggs testified about his grandson being healed of Lyme's disease, and really, really good. So if you missed it this month, come back next month. Not only is it good fellowship, but Ed makes real coffee. And you know what real coffee is. That's when you get to the bottom of the cup, and it's kind of like pudding, you know. That's, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, it was good. Don't drink that bottom part. Let us join with Christians throughout the ages as we affirm what we believe with the Apostles' Creed. It's number 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Almost, not yet. Please join me in the glory of Patri. Yes?
Glory be.
I think that's the wrong one. Okay, now you may be seated. Need to get a couple of helpers here if I can up front. We're going for our tithes and offerings. Attaboy, Steve and David, thank you. Please bow with me. Father, all things come from you. And we honor you by giving back. We bring nothing to you of value except ourselves because you treasure us. We thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Please accept these gifts as our way to bring your kingdom a little closer to earth in a few more places here. In Christ's name, amen.
He's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now, say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Give thanks. Give thanks.
Now, please stand and we will sing the doxology.
Praise God, from whom all things flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Have a seat.
There we go. Well, good morning again. We come to our time of pastoral prayer where we share our joys and concerns, and it's a joy to have everybody here with us this morning. And I have a joy, a personal joy, if you don't mind my announcing it. My son is here with his wife, Leilani. So y'all want to stand up and stand out for just a second? Thank you for that. We do have joys to share today, but we also have a lot of things that we're concerned about. And so we have some folks that need to be lifted up in prayer. We also want to remember the situation that's going on in Israel and Ukraine and all of the conflicts that are going on around the world and everything that's heating up. So we really need to be in prayer every day for that. So will you please join me in prayer? Oh, gracious and glorious God, we thank you for this beautiful morning. We thank you for the cooler weather. We thank you for providing this house where we can come together and worship you in safety and in security, knowing that you love us and that we have no worries about our security. We pray for those who don't have such privileges and such benefits today. We pray that you would protect all of those who are unable to come together and worship you openly. We pray that you would protect them and that you would guard them and that you would also make them bold to share their witness so that their oppressors will turn and join them, that they will be healed by your mighty power. Oh Lord, we know that we have sinned and fallen short of your glory this week, and we ask that you would forgive us of those sins as we confess them to you and restore us to all righteousness in your sight. And we thank you that that's made possible through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, we pray for all of those who are ill this morning, those who are struggling with diseases and injuries, those who just need your healing touch physically, spiritually, and emotionally. We ask that you would be in every situation, Lord, and pour out your healing life into them. Help them to feel your presence and to know your love for them. We pray for police officers, firefighters, military at home and around the world, for teachers and staff and students, and all of those who put their work before themselves and their families. We ask that you would protect them from those who would do them harm. and that you would give them wisdom and clarity when they have to make snap decisions on how to proceed. And Lord, we ask that you would also pour out your blessings on them for the sacrifices that they make. We do pray for conflicts that are going on around the world, and our hearts are heavy today to hear about all of the death and destruction that's happening in the promised land. We pray, Lord, that you would be in this situation, that you would find a way for it to be resolved peacefully. But we ask, Lord, that you would frustrate the plans of the oppressors and the attackers, and that you would help restore peace in the Middle East. It has been so close, and so we just ask, Lord, that you would continue on that. We pray for Ukraine and all of the conflicts around the world, that you would be, we know you're there. Just protect those who are innocent. And again, we ask that you would frustrate the plans of the aggressors. Now, God, we pray for us at home. We pray for this church. We ask that you would bless us as we continue to be your hands and your feet and your heart in our community and beyond. And we ask, God, that you would move in our hearts to be bold, to share your message of forgiveness and reconciliation and restoration with the people we know. There's so many people who need to know how much you love them, how ready you are to forgive them of everything they've ever done, and that you're so ready to restore them. And so, God, we place this all in your hands. We trust in your goodness, and we join together to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. It is time for children's moments. So if the kids will come forward. I guess some of them are in the nursery. You can sing it a cappella. I should have said a prayer for our little gremlin in the sound system this morning, huh? Good morning. Thank you. How are y'all today?
Good.
Well, good. Well, you know, do you remember who Simon Peter is? No, you haven't learned about Simon Peter?
I did in high school.
What did you learn about Simon Peter?
Well, I kind of forgot.
Oh, well, at least you know his name, so that's important. So Simon Peter was a disciple of Jesus, and he went with him the whole 3 years that he was on earth, and he was with Jesus, and was one of his disciples, and learned from Jesus how to be a leader in the church, okay? And what we're studying today is a letter that he wrote to the church. Have you guys ever written a letter? Have you ever received a letter?
Yes.
Do you like that?
Mm-hmm.
Me too. I like getting letters. And I like Peter's letter because he's given us some instructions on how we need to behave and how we need to be looking for, we need to just know God's word. That's the biggest thing that we can do. Do your folks read your Bible to you? I know you get Bible stories at night, don't you? From me. Anyway. Tell your mama Bible stories at bedtime, okay? Because how you can tell the good teachers from the bad teachers is by knowing what the Bible says. So when you get to where you can read, will you promise me you will read the Bible?
Yes.
How about you, Sonny?
I don't know.
Well, when you know how to read, will you? Yes. How about you, Gary?
I don't know how to read.
Well, when you learn how to read, will you read your Bible? That's a promise. So I'm going to hold you to it, okay? Let's pray.
Dear God.
I get to start. Dear God.
Thank you for Jesus.
And the disciples.
And the word you gave us.
When we learn to read,
help us to read it.
Every day.
We love you, God.
Amen. Okay, you can go back and sit with your folks. Oh, you want a candy. You'd think, I always thought I was going to get off. All right, you can get what you get. You're sweet as fish. You don't like chocolate. Okay? Thank you. No, you only get one. Oh, you... That's chocolate. Just trying to help you out here. Here's Sour Patch Kids. How about that? That's not chocolate. Okay.
But personally, I'm gonna miss this one. I appreciate what she's done, and she's led this church through a very difficult period. And I like the way she shares, bears her soul with us. And just want you to know, we're gonna miss you.
Thank you.
And this is a pretty long scripture reading, so you elderly people like Lynn Scruggs, if you don't feel like you can stand during the whole thing, just feel free to sit. So, but the rest of you can stand. So. 2 Peter 3, verses 1 through 18. Hear the word of the Lord from 2 Peter 3, verses 1 through 18. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They'll say, "Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation." But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also, the world at that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we're looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you're looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. He writes the same way in all his letters. speaking in them of these matters. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do to the other scriptures, to their own destruction. Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. So fall has arrived, and it's beautiful, no? We've been taking a walk through Peter's second letter to the church, and today we've arrived at the third chapter and the final chapter. We started with Peter's encouragement to believers to know God's word so that we can stand firm in the face of apostasy. And the second chapter tells us about the coming of false teachers and their fate. And today, he returns to encouraging the church. You know, Peter, Paul, and John all wrote letters to the church at the end of their lives. And I think the main message was, at the end, we want to be found faithful to the Lord. I think that how we will meet our end is something that we all think about from time to time. It reminds me of Will Rogers, who once said, "When I die, I want to go like my grandfather, who died peacefully in his sleep, not screaming in terror like all of his passengers." You know, I tried and tried to think of a really good way to segue into that joke, but it's moving week, so what can you do? As we return to 2 Peter, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, please open our eyes that we may see, open our ears that we may hear, and open our hearts that we may understand the message you have for us today. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this third chapter of 2 Peter is primarily about the day of the Lord, and it can be broken down into three sections. Verses 1 through 4 are the test for apostasy. Verses 5 through 13 are God's plan for the world. And verses 14 through 18 are a reminder to be ready. You know, I love the way J. Vernon McGee writes this part. So let's listen to his version of verses 1 through 4 for the test for apostasy. He says, "Beloved, I now write to you this second letter. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate your sincere minds by way of reminder. I want to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, 'Where is this coming?' He promised. Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation." I love how Peter addresses the church as beloved. We are God's beloved, and it's always good to hear that. In this letter, Peter states that he is the author, apparently without assistance, since he told us in his first letter that he had help from Silas. And he just states plainly that he's writing to remind the church of the truth as given by Christ. You see, the best way to stay close to God is to remember his mighty acts in the world and in our lives. A big part of our worship is remembering. At Christmas, we remember that God came down to the earth in the incarnation. Jesus set aside his divine powers and took on human flesh to become one of us. He experienced all of the joys and the pains that are common to the human experience, and he did so without sin. At Easter, we remember that Jesus suffered and died to atone for our sins, that he was dead and buried, and on the third day he rose from the dead so that we could all be reconciled with God and live with him forever. We celebrate Holy Communion to remember Jesus' sacrifice. We affirm our faith to remember what it is we believe. The feasts of Israel have the same purpose. Not only was Passover instituted to remember the mighty works of God when he delivered the children of Israel from slavery in Egypt, it was celebrated in such a way that the people in each generation were considered to have been there personally and had to have been delivered as well. It is in remembering that we reconnect with the Lord. And that's the purpose of our singing, our affirmations, and everything we do in worship. Do you remember when we talked about the neural pathways in our mind that we repeat to remember? That's what we're doing here. We remember what God has done for us. We remember his promises to us for the future. Then Peter gives us the test of the apostate. They're scoffers. A scoffer is a mocker who speaks of things of faith and of God scornfully and in a derisive way. It reminds me of Sheldon Cooper, you know, my guy from Big Bang Theory. And he most often gives his friends what he calls the look of haughty derision. I can't do it very well. And then he does that every time that they do something he finds stupid. Scoffers make fun of the notion that Jesus is coming back for believers, as well as believers in general. They arrogantly believe that they have intellectual superiority, but it's their intellect that has betrayed them. And so they make fun of God, the creator and sustainer of the universe, the one who fully knows them and fully loves them, to their own detriment. So the attitude toward the return of Christ is a test of apostasy, and the scoffers have failed it. Verses 5 through 13 outline God's plan for the world. 5 and 6 describe the world it was. 7 through 12 describe the world as it is. And 13 describes the world that will be, past, present, and future. Let's listen to Peter's description of the world that was. But they deliberately forgot that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being, and the earth was formed out of the water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. You see, the earth itself testifies that a great cataclysm happened in the past. There are scars and evidence all over the earth. Every single part of the land was once covered with water at some time. And the remains of seashells and sea creatures can be found and have been found on nearly every mountaintop. The earth was once one landmass that was torn apart. If you'll remember the story of creation from Genesis, the earth was initially covered by the waters, and by God's word, the landmasses were brought together to form one continent that we now call Pangaea. Many believe that the earth was covered with a water vapor canopy, and that the earth watered itself from the land, as noted in Genesis 5:6, which says, "Now no shrub had yet appeared upon the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not sent rain on the earth, and there was no one to work the ground. But streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground." How cool! Automatic irrigation. And there were no weeds. A true gardener's paradise. And from Genesis, we learn that the descendants of Adam were so corrupt that their thoughts were only evil all the time. Only Noah and his family were counted as righteous, and God saved them from the world before he destroyed it. And the beautiful, semi-perfect creation was undone. Noah and his family and one set of each animal kind remained to repopulate the earth. But like the children of Adam, we are becoming more and more corrupt. Jesus came to save us from the wrath of God, the just punishment for our sinfulness. And while billions have turned to him, even more have rejected him. Let's hear what Peter has to say about the world that is. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, beloved. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. We learn an awful lot from Peter here. Unlike some of the other writers of Scripture, Peter's direct. I really appreciate that. He plainly says that by God's word, judgment is coming. The ungodly and those who have not accepted Christ will be destroyed. John elaborates for us in Revelation, giving details of the wrath of God that is to be poured out on the world. But Peter simply says, it will be destroyed. With regard to the scoffers who say the world keeps turning, as it always has, Peter says that we should not underestimate God's patience or doubt his promise keeping. Because the Lord is outside of time as we know it, 1,000 years are like a day in his sight. God is waiting for all who will come to repentance. You know, timing is such a funny thing, and most of us do not have that mastered. A story was once told about a father and a son. They were farmers who were discussing what to do with their crops. The father said to the son, "Tomorrow, we will go to market to sell our crops. We must wake up very early in the morning." "Yes, father," the son replied. At dawn the next day, the father and the son woke up, but the father had to spend some time in prayer before they left, and he asked the son to pray with him. The son agreed, but he was really spending the time murmuring about the delay. The father noticed and said, "Slow down, my son. Good things happen in their own time." They proceeded on their way to the market using an ox cart to haul the goods. And when they were halfway to their destination, they chanced upon one of their relatives who invited them in for breakfast. The father happily agreed, and the son silently fumed about yet another delay. Again, the father noticed and said, "Slow down, my son. Good things happen in their own time." So they continued on their journey. They were still several miles from the market when they saw a fellow farmer whose cart was stuck in the wet, soft ground. So they stopped to help him. The father said, "Son, we must help him out of his mess." And this time the son could not hide his anger and disagreement and said to his father, "My father, we are delayed already. Slowing down will allow this fellow to get to the market ahead of us." But the father replied, "Slow down, my son. Our God can make all things beautiful in his perfect time." They helped dig the other farmer out of the mud, and by this time it was nightfall, so the father decided to make camp for the evening. The son furiously complied, not even attempting to hide his anger. And they rose early the next morning, and they were breaking camp when they heard a big bang, an ear-breaking explosion, and they looked to the city ahead and saw an enormous mushroom cloud. It was the bombing of Hiroshima, Japan. Then the son, teary-eyed, said to his father, "Now I understand the meaning of slow down. Had we continued in a hurry, we would have been in the city when the bomb fell. Thank you, my father." In the same way, God is not in a hurry to destroy the world that he loves so much. Jesus' death is sufficient for every person who has ever lived and who will ever live. And God is giving everyone the chance to turn to him and be redeemed. Like the atomic bomb, the day of the Lord will come quickly and unexpectedly. There will be no time to do anything. And because we now have the technology to create weapons of mass destruction, we now understand that God actually can destroy the world by fire. You know, the criticism of past generations is that water can't burn, therefore this must be incorrect. And yet the uneducated fisherman from Galilee was able to give an accurate description of what will happen in the future judgment. He did not know about atoms or the subatomic and quantum world. But basically what happens is that the atom, once thought to be the smallest and indivisible building block of all creation, when split, creates an enormous explosion. The atom is made up of extremely small, positively charged nucleus surrounded by a cloud of negatively charged electrons. What happens within the positively charged electrons when they're unbundled from the negatively charged ones is destruction and annihilation. As Peter said, the heavens will disappear with a roar, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. It's a pretty good description for an ignorant rube, don't you think? We now know of many scenarios where the world could be destroyed by fire, a bomb, an asteroid strike, even mass volcanic eruptions across the globe. So in the meantime, what are we called to be? Well, we're called to be ready for Jesus to return at any time. It means that you should strive to live a life that is pleasing to God. Love God more than anything else. Then love your neighbor. In all things, God is to come first. If you do, your only worry should be for your family and friends who do not believe. Perhaps it will be your testimony that awakens them to the truth of God. Let's turn to the world to come. But in keeping with his promise, we're looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Isn't that beautiful? A new, uncorrupted heaven and a new, uncorrupted earth where righteousness dwells. Everyone will gladly and wholeheartedly live to please the Lord. There'll be no chaos, no homelessness, no violence of any kind. Again, John gives us much more information about that in Revelation 21. In part, he said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there is no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people. And God himself will be among them, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away.'" You can read the full description for yourself in Revelation 21 and 22. It sounds beautiful and magnificent, and I'm excited to be going there. I hope you are too. I hope you're excited enough to bring your family and friends along with you. Then Peter closes his letter with an admonition to believers to live their lives to please God. I think it's kind of funny that he mentions Paul and his letters. He acknowledges that Paul has been given wisdom by God and that people tend to distort what he says for their own gain. I kind of think he had in mind the part where Paul talks about our freedom in Christ. But the funny part is, he admits that Paul writes some things that are hard to understand. You know that impulsive and prideful Peter had to be humbled and changed if he was able to write that kind of a thing about Paul. Let's hear Peter's final word to the church. "So then, beloved, since you're looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul also wrote with the wisdom that God gave him. He writes in the same way in all his letters, speaking in them of these matters. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do with other scriptures, to their own destruction. Therefore, beloved, since you've been forewarned, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position. But grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. You know, those are some great parting words. What's the message? False teachers are coming to deceive believers. Prepare yourself for the attacks by knowing the Word of God. Grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord. See, this world is destined for destruction by God. But take heart. Jesus has come to save us and will come again so that we do not experience God's wrath. Be ready. Have you made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life? Do you love God above all other things? Today is a great day to make that happen. Please join me in prayer. Wonderful, merciful Savior, we thank you for your great love for us, sinners as we are, and for revealing your plans to us and allowing us to be a part of the rescue plan for the world. We know that Jesus is coming again, and we want to be ready. Please help us to be the people you have called us to be. Please help us to share your message of forgiveness and acceptance with the world so that all who will turn to you will be redeemed. Help us to be a holy people, redeemed by the blood of Christ, living our lives as a holy and living sacrifice to you. Protect us from those who would do us harm, and help us to cling to the cross of Christ all of our days. We love you and we honor you, O God. Amen. If you'll please stand, we're going to sing one of my favorite songs, Stand Up for Jesus. You have to stand up while you're singing that, right, Ed?
That's right.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished. Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Forth to the royal conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are brave now serve him against unnumbered foes. Courage rise with danger, and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel peace, put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To those who vanquish evil, a crown of life shall be. They with the King of glory shall reign eternally.
Hear this word of benediction and blessing. You know, I know a lot of people don't like to stand up for Jesus because it's talking about battles and all, but it's talking about a spiritual battle. And we are in the spiritual battle of our lives. We are called to stand up for Jesus. That's what Peter asked us to do, is to stand firm and be ready. And so you need to share that message with your friends. That's your job as a soldier of the cross. Share the good news. So go out today and do that with your friends and your family in the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, and the power of the Holy Spirit that enables you to do it. Amen.
We're going to sing, "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds." One verse.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above.
As the light of Christ goes out, let us go with the light of Christ in Christ's name. Amen.